made you some content. Daddy made you your favorite open wide. Here comes the content. It's a beautiful day to stay inside.
Greetings, mood killers. It's Eddie here with Marconi. We are the diplomats of doom and dysfunction. And Marconi, I noticed something relevant about the current environment or situation, like artwork in the room, a song playing, or something interesting that happened at a party. What are your thoughts on it?
I don't know what you're talking about. I did change something in my studio, if that's what you're talking about. If you look
up. Okay, perfect. Excellent. All right. See, I knew when I asked AI for a conversation starter, this would work. All right, cool.
I changed.
Yeah.
I have a gold framed piece of art in my studio, and I look at it, and now it's a FaceTime photo of Taylor Swift and her cat Olivia. And
is Olivia still alive?
I don't know for sure. I think she is. I think Meredith is alive. She's named after Meredith Grey. Olivia is named after Olivia Benson from Law and Order SVU.
Breaking Bad. Oh, yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, Meredith Grey is from Grey's Anatomy. And then she has Benji, her other cat. And so
Named after Benji Bronk?
Yeah, I think so. Yes. Naturally, okay. Next in line. I think Benjamin Button is who she named it after. Yeah. But, you know, Benji Bronk could be there, too. I don't know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so I changed that. And I like it because I just had, like, a Mood Killers logo there. And I'm like, I know I'm on Mood Killers. We're doing the show. I don't really need a logo. You know, you go into a radio studio, they always got like 50 logos on the wall of the station. Or in some cases, the studios are used by 12 other people from different stations. So they just have a digital plasma screen behind them or something with the logo.
I think sometimes these radio guys, they record their show on so many different radio stations, they literally need the logo in front of them to tell where they are at any given point.
Well, I mean,
otherwise,
but isn't that on the computer screen? You don't need it on the wall. You know what I mean? And usually, like, if somebody takes a picture, the worst thing you can do in a photo, like, say you get one shot, like, you meet Taylor Swift, she comes into your studio, and you get to take a picture with her. And that god-awful, and usually radio logos are really bad.
Oh, they're all bad.
And that god-awful radio logo is in the background, and you can't crop it or whatever. Maybe it's too blurry or something's up with the picture. So then, like, you know, 10 years later, you've been fired and you're on your fifth station from that one. And if you wanted to post that one time you got to take a picture with Taylor Swift, you got to post this picture with this god-awful logo from a station, like, you know, just let me stand against a blank wall. I don't need this logo.
No, I get it. Yeah.
It's not helping anybody.
And also, you know, these radio stations will update their logo.
Yeah.
And then they'll always forget to do the studio. They'll leave like one logo as the old logo for at least 5 or 6 years. So it's not even updated. There's also that. So anyways, radio logos are horrible.
Yeah.
But that's not why why you called.
Yeah, no, I
have a lot to get to.
That's why I put a picture of Taylor Swift and her cat up here because it makes me happy, you know?
I think it's a beautiful photo.
Yeah.
And it really should make you happy every single day. And while we have a lot to get to, as always, Marconi, you know, we always talk about on the show about passengers on airplanes freaking out. But what happens when a pilot reaches his breaking point? I have the answer coming up with the latest in hellish stories in the skies with the unfriendly skies.
Oh, my gosh. You know, Eddie, I had what I was going to tease here coming up, but I think I did that yesterday. The thing I had written down. I was going to talk about the guy. Okay, here's one. Something you can't replace, you know.
Yeah.
Coffee. Can't replace sleep. You've got to get sleep. I'll tell you more about that coming up in a special segment that you might want to take a nap if you need one through. Because, I mean, not that I will bore you to death with the facts, but sometimes I don't mind. We got to let people have a chance, you know, take a nap during the show.
I mean, this sounds like health news. Is this part of Dr. Mood Killers?
Or no, is this, Dr. MK. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah. Right.
Okay. All right. And are you wondering what color to paint your toenails? Maybe you need to get rid of a pesky raccoon. Well, we'll help you out with all of your questions answered with Ask Mood Killers coming up later. And there's still time for you to get in your question right now. Email moodkillers@stayanal.com. This is the only show where hope goes to die.
Don't think I won't bend you over my knee and turn that fat ass red now.
I love these meal kits, Marconi. You and I talk about meal kits all the time here on Mood Killers. They're so delicious. They're easy. They're convenient. And that's why we need to talk about our friends over at Green Chef.
The best. The best. I've tried them all, Eddie. You know I've tried them all. Green Chef does everything perfectly. They put every ingredient in its own little container. There's no guessing. They put it in a little sack for you. And then because like a lot of these meal kits, even the pretty good ones, will just give you a tray of all the ingredients for like five different meals. And you're like, I think this is for that one. But Green Chef packs it in a little bag for you so you don't have any mistakes.
Oh, yeah, that is great. It's easy, it's convenient, and also they have six preferences: calorie smart, plant-based options, quick and easy Mediterranean, protein-packed, and gluten-free, so it fits every lifestyle. And they're the number one meal kit for eating clean. Did you know that? Number one.
I love that. Do they have one for extra gluten? Because I'm feeling glutinous lately. Yeah. I really want more gluten.
That's right.
Green Chef is great. I love them.
We love Green Chef. Go to greenchef.com/moodkillers and use promo code moodkillers. Get 50% off plus free shipping. A lot of people listen to podcasts on YouTube. And just a quick reminder that if you're one of the many people who do that, you can get all of our shows, all of our daily shows. They go right up on YouTube. And it's an easy way to keep it up to date with everything happening.
We just
throw it up there. Yeah. Yeah. I know a lot of people, you know, they're driving to work and they maybe only catch part of the show every day. But in the afternoon, when you're driving home later that day in the evening, you can catch up with the morning show that you missed. Because as soon as we're off the air, the podcast goes up everywhere, including YouTube. So go to youtube.com/@moodkillers.
I know you're fighting that ticket, you know, that you got for you're sitting in traffic and at a dead stop, and I guess answering an email, and the police officer opened. I was wondering, why is it that like there's so much trouble with distracted driving, but then every new car has like a 9-inch screen in it? Like, hey,
I was thinking that because the car I was driving was a rental car, and it literally projects your phone onto the dashboard with Apple AirPlay.
And
I was thinking of that too. I was like, if the cop saw me just pushing my dashboard, like he wouldn't have done anything.
Yeah, so that's okay, but like looking down at your phone, because why? Because the dashboard, the way it's angled. I mean, they don't recommend that you look at like a movie or a TV show while you're driving, but you can still poke around on that dashboard.
I've seen people literally reading novels driving down the street. So,
wow.
And I get pulled over for briefly responding to a very important email. But I'm fighting this, taking it all the way to the top, Supreme Court.
Supreme Court. Yeah. Can't
That's
wait
right.
to see how that goes for you.
Let's see what's happening inside our nation's airports and up there in the skies on the airplanes.
This is your captain speaking. Yes. We are now going to fly the unfriendly skies on Mood Killers.
Flying anuses. That's right. So we talk a lot about passengers on airplanes having meltdowns, but a pilot had a meltdown. I'll tell you what he did in just a second, but first, this one was pretty scary, I thought. There are a lot of near-miss accidents with airplanes, and they're happening a lot, and they don't tell us.
I'm all for the entertainment value that people can get for free by watching, like, the Blue Angels or the Thunderbirds flying in the sky. But I Googled how many accidents, and they have accidents every single year.
I'm talking about commercial though. Commercial but I was just airlines.
Thinking about, but I was just thinking about that. Like, planes are dangerous, and if these people are purposely doing tricks and flipping around and stuff. If regular planes are doing this, it's insane, and it's terrifying. Yeah. Right. I don't like it.
I know. And this is very scary because these near misses happen with commercial flights. And they just don't tell us that more than once a day, every month, two commercial airplanes almost collide.
What?
So this happened 46 times last month, where two commercial airlines in the United States, this is just the United States, almost crashed into each other.
Jeez, get it together. Like, what's going on? Like,
I don't know. But apparently,
like on Breaking Bad, where that guy gets bad news about his daughter before he flies and he just doesn't care anymore and he's drinking before he starts flying and he's like, oh, look.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so a lot of these airplanes, though, they do have safety features like collision warnings. But, you know, when you're going that fast and you're in these big planes, I guess, for example, there was an American Airlines flight a couple of weeks ago. It was taking off in Phoenix. And it banked left instead of right on accident and veered directly into the path of a Southwest flight.
Oh.
And they came in about a third of a mile of hitting each other, which is, you know, it's pretty close. You'd see that other plane if you're looking out the window, like you'd see it right by you. That's a near miss right there, a third of a mile.
At least it's not like a couple of inches or feet or something like that. But still, it's pretty scary because they can travel really fast. So a third of a mile is nothing when it comes to planes because they're going like 800 miles an hour or something.
And it's not even only in the sky. So near misses are happening on the ground. That's even more common. I guess two planes at the Austin airport almost collided on the same runway and they were going about 150 miles per hour each.
Get it together. Come on, air and pilots. These
two came within 100 feet of each other.
What do you think it is?
I don't know. What is going on?
They do this for a living. They're professionals. Like, you know, when you see like a stunt driver or something like that, and you're like, oh man, that's amazing. Like you actually see what they do. They're just so good at it. You'd think that a pilot would be so good at their job that they can.
Now, it's not the pilot's fault a lot of the times.
Okay.
So it's the air traffic controllers.
Oh,
so
no.
I guess they're saying that the number of flights has drastically increased over the past few years, but the number of fully trained air traffic controllers is down 10%.
You know why?
It's just the perfect storm.
Because they don't let anybody that wants to. Like, if you want to, I think the cutoff is age 35. And like, there's got to be people over the age of 35 that would think, hey, you know what? Maybe I could be an air traffic controller. And maybe it just doesn't pay enough. I don't know what the deal is, but
I thought they made pretty good money. I don't know.
I'm guessing. I would think so. And
I would bet budget cuts is why, you know.
Wasn't that the dad in Breaking Bad? That was his job, right? He was the air traffic controller. And he found out his daughter died from an overdose. And then
He
lost his mom.
Walter White for a second. No, you mean Jane's dad?
Yeah. And remember that? And then, like, they're sitting at the bar the night before talking about their problems.
Oh, yeah.
And then he goes into work the next day and then that whole thing with the stuffy with the eyeball falling in the pool. that eyeball they kept teasing over and over in that show, like a preview. You'd see it every other episode. Like, okay, there's a hazmat suit. There's an eyeball falling from the sky. What's going on?
Uh-huh.
And you find out it's the air traffic controller losing his mind.
It's a great show. Breaking Bad, in case anyone hasn't seen that.
Thank you.
It's new, I think. Check it out.
This is your captain speaking. We are now going to fly the unfriendly skies on Mood Killers.
Yes, what's happening up in the sky, flying anuses, tell you that much, and at our nation's airport. So we talk a lot about passengers having meltdowns on airplanes, but now a United Airlines pilot, he said he had enough.
No.
A pilot. So luckily he wasn't in the air when he had the meltdown. He was actually outside of the airplane on the tarmac at the Denver International Airport, and he somehow found an axe. And he started using the axe to attack a parking gate arm. You know, one of those arms that go up and down?
Yeah.
So, Yeah, so he was hitting this axe over and over and over and over again, and then two airport employees, they had to wrestle the axe away from the guy.
Wow.
Before the pirate destroyed anything else. The pirate? Yeah.
Oh, man.
But yeah, he said he did this because he, quote, reached his breaking point as a pilot.
So okay.
So that's going on.
I don't know what the stresses are of being a pilot. You know, they fly in there, and they're pretty much, you know, the king of the ship when they're in there. They don't have to deal with you'd think that it would happen more with the flight crew than it would with a pilot. I don't know. You know?
I know. He's the king. But he can do no wrong.
I'm guessing, like, you know, you've got to get to this town by a certain time. You got to stay on time. And everything's got to be working right. And you know.
You got to duct tape people to their seats. It's terrible.
Things like that. Yeah. So, I mean, I'm sure there's stresses we don't have any clue about. But taking an axe, like, what's the point of that? Like, just go home.
Had enough.
Go home and do it. Go to your hotel, you know?
Go to one of those, what are they called, break rooms or rage rooms?
You go to rage room. Knock some bottles around. Take a sledgehammer to a car, whatever.
That's right. I do have a couple of good news stories relating to air travel, but real quickly, first, 22 flyers have been referred to the FBI for criminally bad behavior on planes in just the last month, and they're saying that these numbers keep going up and up and up. 270 cases referred to the FBI since 2021. And the allegations include sexually assaulting passengers, attacking flight attendants, trying to break into the cockpit, making terror threats, and smoking an airplane lavatory.
I hate you very much.
God.
People are maniacs.
Yeah.
Maniacs. Everyone loses their minds on the airplanes. I just don't understand. But, you know, it gives us plenty of content right here. So
keep it coming so we can keep doing the show.
Up.
Yes.
Have fun. Just not when anyone listening is flying.
Right.
Or us. Sure.
Yes.
No mood killers, listeners, need to be affected by this. So a couple of travelers, they met while traveling. They were on an airplane going to Reykjavik, Iceland, and they sat next to each other. And about an hour into the flight, they started to chat. And now it looks like they are making the biggest mistake of their lives. 8 months later, they're getting engaged.
Oh, how wonderful!
Oh, God. Don't do it. Whatever you do.
Yeah. Yeah. So good luck with that. And then a cat story real quick. A cat escaped while boarding an airplane. This is another Denver International Airport story. This somebody was trying to fly with their cat. You've flown with your cats before, right?
Yeah.
They flew right in the cockpit with the pilot. Is that
cat
right?
Cat pervert.
Yeah. Yeah. No. One had to be down underneath in the luggage, which killed me.
Yeah.
Like that. They put, you know, you have to do a whole special thing to let your cat fly underneath. And then I carried my older one up with me. They were both fine, but I felt heartsick. I still think about it. It makes me upset.
Cat pervert.
You know.
I just don't understand why the cat can't sit on the pilot's lap and keep it coming.
Cat pervert.
Yeah, I know, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Yeah. Anyways, it was a cat that was being stowed underneath the plane in the luggage, and then he got loose. But luckily, they were able to wrangle the little cat Breezy. They found him, and he is now safe. And he was given a free hotel room nearby until his
nice
owners returned. Yeah. So there you go. That's what's happening up there in the skies. Careful. Watch out for those flying anuses.
Eddie, coffee can't replace sleep.
I don't believe it.
You've got to prioritize sleep. I know you don't do this, and it worries me because you're always going, and I understand. I respect that. I'm not, I don't try to tell you how to live your life, but
you're about to.
When I hear all the stress and stuff, I'm like, well, part of it is because he's not getting good sleep. So anything that happens in a bad situation, you handle things pretty well, I know. But if you don't have sleep, I'm always bad with it. Like, if I'm not getting enough sleep.
No, you're right.
You've seen me in situations where something normally wouldn't set me off and it sets me off for no reason. It's because I haven't had sleep. And
no, you're right. Yeah, I have noticed if I have a lack of sleep, I am more reactive and I usually kind of you know, say things I might regret. But I've stopped reacting instantly to things when people have problems.
Yes.
And this has probably been the biggest life hack ever I have discovered, because a lot of people come to me with problems every day with work, and I used to want to jump on it and solve their issues immediately. And now I'm just like, I'll get to it when I'm ready.
Let them stew.
Yeah. Is anything really that urgent in radio?
No.
No.
And you know, like,
and everybody overcomplicates everything.
You know, it's really crazy. I like that you say that, because it's true. Nothing is urgent. We're not surgeons, and most of us in our lives. People are constantly, you know, telling you, you know how, like, if you go to a party and there's always that guy, I got to get up at 4 a.m. I can't stay out. I can't do anything. I got to be up at 4 a.m. or I've got to be up at, you know, it's always a competition. Who has to get up earlier? Yeah. Who has to work the longest?
They brag about it.
Yeah. It's a weird thing.
I got to be up at 4 a.m. to work at 16.
But I will say
this.
And
I'm on my 15th day straight.
It's harder and harder for me, because I've always been one that could sleep in like 4-hour shifts. I guess I learned that there are a lot of people in history, great men, who are known for doing this.
Jeffrey Dahmer.
Yes. Jeffrey Dahmer is one of them. Yeah. No, but I don't feel like that makes me great in any way. I think it's just because, you know, with morning radio, you're so used to getting up at the crack of dawn before anyone's awake. And like, so you find a way to sleep in 4-hour shifts, and that's.
Yeah. I used to stress myself out over that. I would get really angry or not angry. I would get stressed if I didn't get 7 to 8 hours continuously. But then I've been reading up on it, and you're right. In fact, our biology, from what I understand, from what Google tells me, who knows if it's true or not, but what I read is we can sleep in shifts and it's totally fine for our bodies. So if I get, you know, 4 or 5 hours of sleep, I might take a 2-hour nap later and be fine with it, not be stressed.
And that's the thing too, is I like a good nap, but I try to get to bed at a reasonable hour, you know, at least by 9:30 or 10 or so. And that's, you know, pushing it. But what I've done lately, and I notice any little thing can throw off my schedule. And then suddenly I'm back to like looking at TikToks at 3 a.m. You know, what am I doing? And right. I don't know what it is. Why is it that you can't put the TikTok down? There's so many different things and nothing's really happening. Like
it sucks you in. That algorithm is the most evil, genius thing ever. It really is.
Because I'm a big fan of Gilmore Girls and Taylor Swift, right? And that is my entire timeline. And what happens is there's a lady that's a key set costumer on Gilmore Girls. So she tells you all the behind the scenes stuff. In this scene, what really happened here is when so-and-so was yelling their lines, and then we had to cue so-and-so to run down the street. And then if they screwed up their line, she had to run all the way back. And like all these different details. And I'm infatuated with this and I'm obsessed. And then this woman is like live on TikTok at night, talking about things. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I get a chance to talk to somebody who knows the Gilmore Girls, you know, like she worked with the people on that show. I'm fascinated by it. So, and then I'm like, what am I doing? You know, and this woman is really nice. She's answering all these questions and stuff. And I'm like, I should be asleep. This is ridiculous.
Why? Right.
I got to get up. Like, what am I doing? I can't replace it with caffeine.
Yeah.
Eddie, a dog ate his owner's passport before the couple, they're about to go to Italy for a wedding.
Oh, jeez. The dog ate the passport.
And first of all, I think the dog did them a favor because they're trying to do one of those destination weddings.
And I don't like those.
And
yeah,
the, you know, because look, Italy, of course, is amazing. But the last thing I want to do is I was in Italy once. I had to go to a wedding. So you get to go to Italy. And you have to pay all that money, but then in the middle of it, you have to go to a wedding.
And nobody likes weddings, let's be honest.
No.
They're horrible, especially the long ceremony. And then, you know, you go to the reception, it's always the same thing, crappy food, terrible dancing. And then you just try to get out of there quickly without anybody noticing.
You're sweaty in those clothes. And, you know, if you're lucky enough to have your own tuxedo or whatever you're wearing, suit, great. But then a lot of people wear rental clothes and you're sweating all night and drinking way too much. I don't want that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just all, it's terrible. I like that we can ruin weddings. Somebody's happiest day of their life, we can ruin on this show.
Yes, yes. So this dog ate the passport, and I think they're trying to figure it out, but they may, it may screw up their whole plan. And that would be bad, because you know there's a lot of money involved in that, and you won't be able to get those. And I always wonder, like, those deposits that are non-refundable, I get kind of, because it's partial business, because if somebody can't make the thing, they can't really book it last minute, and they had to reserve it, and they knew what was going on. But then, you know, there's got to be, like, you should be at least get, like, 25% of your deposit back or something, you know? It seems too restrictive.
It is.
Because weddings are such a racket, man. You look at the people getting married these days. I don't know how they do it.
It's so much money. It's like dropping 50 grand or 30 grand. You might as well put that toward a down payment on a home. I just don't understand why people don't do it. If you have that kind of cash to throw down on a wedding, why would you not buy something tangible like a home? And then have a celebration with your friends. Go to Bennigan's. Call it good.
Go to Bennigan's.
Go down to Scooters. See,
on one hand, you're going to go to the bar. On the other hand, you go to Italy and spend, you know, 50K for one day. Yeah, it is.
Yeah, no.
It
thanks.
Is weird because I'd rather have that money in the bank, to be honest. And look, I'm not saying that some people, they know how to do it right. They figured it out. They found the right partner. But most of these weddings, I mean, you know, you spend all of, you know, some people spend their entire lives thinking about their wedding day. And they think more about that day than they do about the person that they're going to spend it with. And that's the problem with it, is they think about, you know, the decor.
And part of it is like the excitement in the relationship becomes planning the wedding. And then the wedding happens and there's nothing to look forward to. And then people are like, oh, crap, now I have to pay attention to you. And I just realized they don't like you.
And usually, you know, they always, you know, like traditionally it's like supposed to be, especially back in the day, or, you know, and some people have traditional lives and they wait until the wedding night to be intimate, which I think is a big mistake because.
Oh, then, terrible.
Then, what if the person's awful in that department in intimacy ways? Yeah. And you're like, I don't like.
Or what if you're just not compatible? Because you do realize that with people is not everybody gets along in the bedroom. Right. It's just a fact.
Yeah. So, I mean, it just seems like, and most people I think nowadays know, but not everyone does. Some people still adhere to that. And I think it's a mistake because you're spending all this money on a wedding and it's a big deal. The entire family comes out. People, your relatives you've never seen before, you know, they're come out of the woodwork and they're giving. The one thing I will say, the best part about a wedding is the gifts, you know?
Yeah.
And if you stay together at least 6 to 9 years, you don't have to give those back. So, I mean, but if you have to call
I'm owed
off,
like 3 used toasters at this point.
Yes, exactly. It's worth the 3 used toasters.
Ask Moon Tailors.
We love to help everyone out. You know, we have helped out thousands of people. That Tony Robbins guy, the motivational speaker, he does these big seminars and a lot of people come and visit him. We've helped out more people than Tony Robbins.
Oh, I think you're going to say
our segment.
We helped him out, but are we? Yeah, he learned
that's
from
who.
Us.
He called us. He had a lot of questions.
You know, Gary V takes. He listens to this podcast, this show, and he gets ideas. Yeah. You know,
that's right. Yeah, Anthony Robbins called us up, and he had a whole laundry list of questions. Everyone knows it.
Is Anthony Robbins still alive?
Tony Robbins.
You okay, yeah. I was thinking because Gary. I was thinking like the modern version of that is the Gary V, right? He's everywhere. I see.
Oh,
him.
Okay, yeah, he's everywhere. I think Tony Robbins is still alive.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he still has that headset microphone and everything.
He looks like Lurch, with black hair. I always think, you know, Lurch.
Yeah,
from
he's
the
Adam's Family. A little too much. He seems like a nice guy, but he's a little too much.
Something
like,
kind
of intense. One of those guys. Like, I wake up at 3 in the morning. I have a shake. I go to the gym for 5 hours. And then I go run my business. Yeah. Then I go back to the gym.
You find he's got a vial of his cousin's blood hanging around his neck for no reason. You're like, what's going on?
Yeah.
But let's answer some questions. If you have an advice question, you need some help, we're always happy to give you advice here on Ask Mood Killers. Mood Killers, what can I do to get out of a creative rut?
Yeah, you just you got to give yourself time. I will say the worst thing you can do is force it. Some people are really good when you give them a deadline, and then the 11th hour, they'll come up with a thing. But I think you got to, like, have a loose type of schedule if you're trying to be creative. I always find like, I got to sit down. I got to not think about it for a long time, you know, especially if it's a specific thing that I'm supposed to do. It takes me longer than if it's just random stuff. Like, if it's just like, hey, just, you know, paint a canvas, do whatever you want. But if somebody's like specific, they need, you know, like if they custom order something, like, we need you to sound like, you know, a French guy with petting a poodle. Then it takes me a while to do that voiceover. You know what I mean? But
Yeah, I think, like, one thing is to do something that is unrelated to whatever you need to be creative in. So go see a movie, go for a walk. I don't
go
know,
to one of those axe bars and throw an axe at a target.
Yeah, yeah. Get liquored up and throw axes.
Yeah, there you go.
That's what you need to do. That's right. That's how you get out of a creative rut. Yeah. Mood Killers, how do I find the courage to change careers and pursue a new opportunity?
Man, that's crazy. You just got to do it.
Just do it.
The one thing I found is the scariest things aren't that scary.
Just do it
later on. Like, if you just go and do it, it's not that scary. You know,
look at us. We were bigwigs over there at the diaper and bib factory, and we had an opportunity to pursue a career in radio at an advanced age.
Advanced. Well, in the diaper and bib factory, we were like, we're not moving up any further than we already are. So let's just jump out of this and, you know, when we can, give our 2 weeks notice and cut ties with this place. And, you know, let's start doing our own show.
Yeah. When the diaper is full, you move on. That's what we said at the bib and diaper factory.
Exactly.
And you know, when the diaper is full, I mean, you can't put a timer on that. And apparently this person's diaper is full in whatever career they're currently in. So
the quote is from the show. Yes. When the diaper is full, time to change it. And that really,
that's really some great life advice. I think
it applies to pretty much anything.
When the diaper is full, it's time to change it. From Mood Killers.
Ask Mood Killers.
We're answering your questions. Send them in. moodkillers@stayanal.com is our email address. You can also find us on social media and reach us there, and we'll hump you out right here on the air.
Wait,
we are answering
questions.
Did you just
say we'll hump you out?
Yeah.
Because that seems like
we'll hump you out.
That's like hey, it's a hump day, everybody, coming at you.
We're going to help you out here on the big show. I don't know what that means, but it sounds like something a radio person would do while wearing a Hawaiian t-shirt. And nobody would want that. Mood Killers. How can I effectively manage and lead a team with diverse personalities and skills?
Wow. I don't want to be a boss because I've, like, you know, in my experience in radio, there are times when I had to be the captain of the team. Now, I didn't set out to be anybody's boss. I wanted to goof around. The reason I got into the radio industry, the business, is to just goof around and have fun. I don't want a bunch of responsibilities, like a real job. And
everyone hates the boss, too.
Yeah,
I mean, if you're the boss, there's no winning, really.
I want to be beloved. And so if I get a team of people around me, and then I've got to be the bad guy, like, hey, you guys got to do your shows, do your stuff, do your work. And then suddenly, like, yeah, everybody's mad at me for whatever, and I'm not part of the, you know, the fun crew that goes out and has beers after work, and I'm always excluded. Then I'm left alone. I didn't want to do that. I like hanging out. I like having fun.
People are a nightmare to manage. They really are. They're terrible. There's always going to be somebody not doing their job. There's always going to be a disagreement between two of your your workers. It's just never going to go smoothly. If you want to effectively manage people, fire them all. I say that's what you do.
You know what the worst thing
get
is?
Get rid of them all.
Is if you're in a situation in a work environment and somebody has something against you and they're always a jerk to you and you don't say anything, you don't say one word, but it's always, you guys need to learn how to get along. Like, no, no, no. I don't need to learn anything. I have said nothing or done anything to deserve this treatment. They're the ones who need to work it out because I don't have a problem at all. I don't ever have to talk to them. I don't have to look at them. I can stay away. But it's always you get glommed on to someone else's issue with you. It's always your fault too. And I hate that. Like if someone doesn't like you, that is not my problem, you know?
Right.
And I hate when management will do that. Like, you guys have to work this out. Like, no, I don't. I have no problem. I'm not the one that's the jerk, you know? I'm just doing my job.
This is why people are a nightmare. There's just no winning.
Yeah.
It's just terrible. Never become the boss. That's
there you go. There you go.
Mood killers, what's the best way to mend a broken relationship?
Move on. You know?
Yeah, forget it. There's enough people out there for you to disappoint.
It really is. Like, I know when you're in love or you think you're in love, but listen, give it some time. That'll pass. You'll forget about it. Usually people want to go back to something that they had because they don't have anything currently. Give it enough time. The thing people are so weird about is they're so worried about a timetable of like, well, what if I wait too long and then it's too late? It's not too late. You're going to find somebody if you want to. And even if the thing is the harder you try, the less it's going to work out. If you just let it happen and enjoy your own company for a while, stop being such a, I hate to say this, but stop being such a loser that you have to be with somebody all the time in order to justify an existence. Be alone. Go to a movie
stop
by yourself.
Stop being a loser.
Yeah. Go to a concert by yourself. Get to be your own friend. You know why? Because then you're going to be the best partner because you don't need anybody to be in your life to be complete. But if you,
that's right.
If you are always dependent on being with someone, then you're needy and nobody likes that. It's not attractive.
That's right. Go to a restaurant by yourself, go to a concert, ride a tandem bicycle by yourself. Just do it.
Go to a restaurant and order multiple entrees and just sit there until you're done.
Yeah. Put one plate across from you and just let it sit there and get cold and take it home as leftovers.
Yeah, there you go.
You know, it's really that easy. This isn't rocket science, but good luck to you.
Just do it.
Yeah, and stop being a loser. Yeah, just do it.
Just do it. I'm going to regret that saying. I don't think people are losers. I just think that it's a weakness that everyone.
Stop having a loser mentality.
There you go. Thank you.
Don't have the mentality of a loser because you're not one.
That's what Gary Vee would say. Stop having a loser mentality.
That's right. Just do it, I say.
Just do it. Mood.